yesterday was the best sports day since the pandemic started, right? We missed out on March Madness, conventional timeline for the NBA Finals, but we had the U.S. Open. Obviously, great NFL game. And let's react. Excuse me. Reaction or no action?
Ah.
Right? A little segment you guys do, you and Tyler.
You're there. The big seat's treating you well.
Yeah. Yeah. Tyler Foljam, obviously, I'm filling in for him today. All right. Ridiculous. Ridiculous ending in Big D yesterday. Do you trust Dallas after what you saw, and especially the horrendous start? Really?
I'm going to cut you off. I'm going to say no. I trust them less now than I did going into that game. I like them a lot. You and I have talked about this all summer. I like them a lot coming into this season. After that game yesterday, nice comeback. I don't trust them at all. That line opened with them as a 7-point favorite. They dropped all the way down as low as 1. It went off around 3, depending upon the book. It's not about the offensive line. The injuries were the story. The defense stinks. 59 points allowed through 2 games. An average of 400 total yards of offense allowed through 2 games. And they've only gotten 2 sacks against statuesque quarterbacks in Jared Goff and Matt Ryan. That's the biggest problem right now. Mike McCarthy is another problem. This team is starting slow. They've been outscored 27-0 in the first quarter through 2 games. Mike McCarthy was supposed to be an upgrade over Jason Garrett. Now I find myself wondering, is he an upgrade over Jason Garrett?
I'm not worried at all. I guess it depends where you classify the Cowboys. I still think they're the best team in the division, sort of by attrition.
Washington's hot.
But I also think it's a component of, are they the elite in the NFC? Of course not. But I think they're the second tier. Football, it's a long season. We have 16 games. Look at the last handful of teams that have participated in the Super Bowl, or at least been a 1 seed or 2 seed. They've all kind of had a wonky game along the way. And I think the 4 fumbles, 3 lost, whatever it is in that first half, first quarter, it's just, you kind of just need to throw it out. So you raise a good point, because the defense is worrisome to a certain extent. But look who they played. Atlanta's offense has never had an issue, right?
Never.
Tons of firepower. Julio Jones and Ridley made some ridiculous catches. And Dan Quinn had some nice fourth down decisions. So I'm okay that those guys made plays. And then the Rams, obviously, what Sean McVay's doing with that offense kind of just advanced Jared Goff.
Good.
Let's assess them as we go on. Now, if this is a recurring issue, then I got issues. But the offense obviously looked great. Dak looked great as well. And the special teams.
What about that hands team? Have you ever seen an onside kick in your life like that? It was like curling. Everyone was just waiting for it to nestle right in
there. Well, it's like
what
Chris Collinsworth said. He felt I was watching a putt at the U.S. Open, right?
Like, yes.
The way, and I also don't blame the guys on the hands team, because they're like, well, it's dying at the 5 yards in. It's not going to go another 5.
They should have had a cocktail in their hand so they could have just enjoyed themselves a little bit more by the pool there. Unbelievable.
David Lloyd on SportsCenter said, politely, let's Dallas field the ball. All right, so another little bit of a surprise, at least most of the game, was the Chiefs and Chargers. So Justin Herbert gets the start in place of the injured Tyrod Taylor. Didn't see that coming. I don't think the Chiefs did as well. Given that the game was so much closer than we expect, what's your reaction in terms of the Chiefs' concern there? But first, we should mention that the books had got buried. This is one of the worst days they can remember, now that legalized sports betting is in 20 states or so. David Purdom does a wonderful job. He has a piece on for ESPN.com's chalk section, just talking about how the masses all won, the public won.
Favorites had a very good day. Now, against the spread, 7-7. But for those guys who like to put together the massive favorite parlays, the massive favorite teasers, the teasers were fantastic.
Right, the money lines too.
You and I had a lot of exposure on Kansas City yesterday in teasers. And we knew going into the afternoon, this had the potential for disaster. And I'm sitting there and it's like, all right, how is this going to go south? Is it going to be Baltimore that gets me in the teaser, or Kansas City? And then Justin Herbert takes the field. I have 200,000 data feeds following me at any point in my life. And never had I heard Justin Herbert was playing in this game.
Right.
So I thought to myself, that's how they're going to get me. That's how they're going to get me in this game. And sure
enough.
Because
everything went well early.
Yeah.
You knew something, curveball was coming.
Not at all concerned about the Chiefs. The Chargers play them well. I believe in the Patrick Mahomes era, the Chiefs are 4-1 against the Chargers, but the margin of victory is only around 5. And the Chargers with Phillip Rivers went to Arrowhead on a Thursday night, I want to say a couple years ago, and came back from 14 down in the fourth quarter and got after them. They were able to get 4 pass rushers after Mahomes and then drop 7 in the coverage. That's how you get the Chiefs. Not many teams could do that. The Chargers could. Didn't surprise me that they were able to put the wood on them for a little while.
And they came back and won and got it done. Obviously, you can't play your best in every game. We're hoping to see their best a week from today because it's a marquee Monday night game. Chiefs at the Ravens. Both teams 2-0. Both teams considered the top 2 teams in the AFC. Now, this line is 3. The Ravens are favored by 3. It was 2.5, but now it's solid 3. But the over-under, what would you need? Given what you've seen from the Chiefs' defense and offense and the Ravens' offense, what would you need the total to be to bet under in that game?
59. I feel like if you get just shy of 60, I'm going to sit there and go, this is ridiculous. I still wouldn't be comfortable. This total surprises me. These two played each other in week three last year at Arrowhead. They put 61 points on the board. Now, that's just one game. We can't look at that and say, well, because that happened then, this is going to happen now. But what shocks me about this number is the books know that the public loves to bet overs, especially in primetime games,
right,
especially with good quarterbacks. You get a great quarterback in Mahomes, a great quarterback in Jackson. These teams routinely put points on the board. Why would they not do it again? That's why I stare at this and I think to myself, am I walking into a trap here, Douglas? Am I walking into a trap?
No, I know a really sharp group, a professional syndicate that bet the over this morning. So
over.
They liked it as well.
That's what I'm thinking. It feels like it's just sitting there for me.
Right. Huh? Get it now because it's going up as we just.
You got to figure it might get up to 54, 55.
I would agree with that. Okay, let's keep it in the AFC because last night the Patriots, obviously all eyeballs were there. Yeah,
great
they took
game.
Care of business in week one against the Dolphins at home. We expected that. But this would be a great litmus test. Face Russell Wilson, the Seahawks in Seattle. And yes, they got stopped on the stop short Frank Costanza style, but on the 1 yard line. But
that's my move.
Yeah. I will say I walked away probably more impressed in terms of like the scale of 1 to 10, higher sort of delta. Like I'm more impressed on New England than I was on Seattle because I kind of expected that from Seattle more so than I expected that from New England.
That was a very good football game. I lost money on that game.
Mm-hmm.
You won money.
Yes.
You had the Seahawks. I had the Patriots, the 2-point conversion. How much were you sweating at the end there?
Oh, tons. I mean, you got a guy on the goal line.
Ripping through
the
shirt.
And Chris Collinsworth earlier in the game had said, I don't know how you stop this. That doesn't instill a lot of confidence when I need them to stop this. So, but look, Cam Newton's been great. I have a ticket on Bill Belichick to win Coach of the Year because I think if they win the division and outperform a lot of the expectations having lost Tom Brady, I think there's something to be said about what Belichick is doing. And clearly, you see he and Josh McDaniels are doing wonders with Newton. It's kind of just a new toy because they don't have that dual threat like they did. They have it now that they didn't have with Brady. But
one note on Belichick last night, should have called timeout there after the Edelman reception.
Right.
That 18-yard reception. They ran up to the line. They tried to run another play. They went from like 36 to 13 seconds, 9 seconds, and they still had two timeouts. Average play takes about 6 seconds. So those two timeouts weren't going to be that useful to you in that situation.
And they could have, then they wouldn't have needed it on the goal line. They would have had more time.
Could have had to run another play.
I think Henry was the call.
Yeah.
The Harry, the last play they did.